If I only had the ability to comment, you know?
Yeah. That is, but I like the passion. Thank you so much for everyone in the chat for that. We'll get it. There we go. All right. All right. So real quick for the ones that are jumping on YouTube, thank you so much for being here. Let's do this intro just for a second to make sure you get caught up. Remember, this is perfect for you to get started with no code and AI and machine learning. We have a guest star here with us today, Corey. So again, we're just catching you up. Thanks so much for coming in here on YouTube.
Backwards rewind.
Exactly. Okay. Now people are like, hey, good to see you. Okay. Look, great to see you. All right. Good times, everybody. All right. So if you've been here on Twitter, you're on YouTube, you're on Twitch, remember, wherever you're at, this is all about no code for beginners, and this is for AI and machine learning. So remember, Corey's here. He's an expert. Thank you so much. So let's get right into this, okay? So we're going to be talking about the framework of how to get started with no code and AI and a couple different questions. So the first question I have for you, Corey, is like, why should you even get started with AI and machine learning in no code anyway?
AI is the new magic, I think, for many people. I think AI, as far as enabling things in applications, is web was 5-6 years ago, maybe, like, let's say mobile 5-6 years ago and web 10 years ago. Like, oh, why should I go on the internet? Or why should I make a mobile application? The next step is, why should I have AI in my application? And for me, it's like the next evolution of getting machines to do what we want. So, we're communicating with machines and we're actually, making a lot of different processes, whether you're working with design, business, manufacturing. There will always be AI use cases. And even I wake up every day and I hear a new use case of how AI is solving a problem. So I'm not like, thinking AI is like the new Jesus and, it'll cure everything. But if you're building any sort of product or tool, AI could probably help in some sort of process within there and making predictions, whether it's for your user's sake or your own sake, as far as actually being a builder or a creator.
Okay, excellent. And let's talk about that for just a moment. You were talking about use cases, builders. Which, could you talk about like one or two projects that really stand out in your mind? Like, you've worked with so many different people in this space. Could you talk about like something that a builder has made for themselves or a user and you're like, oh my God, that's crazy. Like, that's perfect.
Yeah, there's tons out there, to be honest. And we at Peltarion, we have a startup accelerator program where if you have an AI idea and building a product, we will take you on for basically 6 weeks. It's technically 7 weeks, but last week is like a demo day. And we help you kind of train and actually building first kind of framing an AI problem. And we'll probably talk a little bit more about what that means later on. And then secondly, getting into ideas of collecting data, which I see is another question that's great to talk about, actually modeling and then bringing that actually to the real world into an application. Preferably if you build it with no code, that's great. But the use cases that come out of there have been absolutely incredible. So this cohort that we have now, we have one team that's kind of building things around gardening and detecting sort of plants within your and making suggestions on what to plant with that within your own gardening tools. So we have like gardening AI. We have a slaughterhouse based in Croatia. So they are actually doing detection. So like you have people that sit in a factory and, the cows and the chickens and all of the meat and stuff that goes there, and they have to label what it is. So why not have an AI be able to sort of detect some of that and make their lives easier? So gardening, slaughterhouses. We have a couple of teams doing work with designers. So like they're doing like a design matchmaking. So let's say you have a durable portfolio and stuff like that. And you want to see what other designers kind of have your vibe or same style and how well they're doing. So AI can kind of do some of that work as well as doing matchmaking and similarities on things. So the use cases are almost endless. You just have to come with the mindset and come with the right data.
That is crazy. Okay, so let's, that's really interesting. That is all over the place. I was not expecting that.
Okay, welcome to my world.
Okay, so let me ask you this. You mentioned mindset first, right? What do you mean by that? Do you think it's almost should they already have a framework of like, this is what I need to accomplish? Or do you think it's almost like the framework of like not even having expectations, just trying to say, just imagining what they could try to do with the landscape, and then you're just going to hone it in and say like, this is possible, this is not possible? Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to be that guy. Like I always say, you know, tell me your craziest ideas, because then some people might limit themselves and not know what is possible with AI. So I'm always open to let me know what you think AI can do, and I will either scale it down or maybe even scale it up in some cases, because some people don't know. But I do think, you know, it's great to have some sort of framework in mind of, okay, I know what AI provides, which is essentially in most cases a prediction or some sort of generation. So lots of people come to me and they'll say, you know, I want AI to, you know, write this document, label it all, and then finish the ending sentences of all my documents or something like that, which is a cool use case. And there's some tools that can do that, especially around the text generation. But you don't want to, like, I guess, over rely on AI as far as what the actual end result's going to look like. And that's, I think, what's the number one key is, like, what is the world going to look like after I put AI to work? So like how the predictions are working, like either they're going to drive a process. So let's say, for instance, the cow carcasses, like maybe you have the AI go in and they label all of the cows and the chickens, and then they go down different routes, right? Okay, maybe that's what you use AI for. Or the AI could provide that prediction and help someone say, oh, you know, AI predicted this, but they're also still, you know, a human in the loop or providing the feedback. So this thinking that, you know, AI is always about predictions, and how you want to use those predictions is really important, I think, especially when you're building a product.
Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. And by the way, we see some on Twitter. Lee, thank you so much for being in the chat with YouTube. I know Erica is coming over there. That's great to see you, Thomas. I see you over there on Twitter. Oh, no, on Twitch. Excuse me. All you people, all different areas. Remember, this is a party. You can stay on your collective platform that you love. We always chill on YouTube as well. Wherever the party is, just let me know. And remember, this is for you. This was our most requested deep dive for 2022. In the chat, let me know what you're working on. What are you seeing? What are you having questions on? Because you've got the man of the hour right here to tell you about machine learning and AI. So, you know, use it. All right. So anything in the chat, let us know. Or if you're watching this on replay, just do hashtag replay and let us know your questions. Okay. So those were very interesting use cases. now, we've got all this stuff you mentioned. Okay. Keeping in mind what you want to do and then narrow in. Now, let's just talk about what should you do first? So you've got different ideas. I've been getting a lot of questions. We talked about this offline a while ago, but I keep getting questions on this. Either stock market portfolios, like what they should be doing in the stock market, or just trying to do things with like NFTs. And I actually have some new stuff to show you as well. But nice. If you're trying to do something like that in the space, how do they even get started? That's just an example. If you're like, use another example to get started, let me know your thoughts.
Yeah. So in most cases, AI will always start with the data. So that's, you know, you're training a model and you're basically giving it information to learn from, so that when it sees new information, it can make correct predictions. So you always want to, when you have this idea or a concept or a problem that you want, a problem space that you want to work with, let's say stock market, then you want to say, okay, where can I find stock market data? Or am I even able to find good stock market data? And you don't have to get specific, especially in this early days. Like you don't have to say, I want the stock market predictions from the last 10 years in tech stocks. It's great to get those kind of ideas in there, but it's fun for me at least to then explore and find out what's out there. There's tons of free data out there. You'd be surprised, especially when it's like historical data, because sometimes, you know, there's no skin in the game or no financial risk as far as like, okay, you know, 10 years ago, here's all the stock market data so that you can have it, where maybe, you know, the recent year or, you know, predictions for next year aren't available. But yeah, that's the best place to start is where can I find this data? And I wouldn't even worry about questions like how much data, which we'll talk about later, but how much data do I need? Or is it data? Is it clean data? Or, you know, all these things. First, just start looking out there. So there's tons of free resources. So there's sites like Kaggle, which can be intimidating if you've never worked with AI or data science before, because that's where all the data scientists hang out and find data sets. But they're completely free and they're usually quite clean and annotated, which is another key part of working with AI, is you want to have some labeled data that makes sense and is consistent. There's also things if you go into Reddit. There's a data set subreddit I highly recommend, because you'll see people post data sets, and then you can see also people request data sets. So if you have something in mind, let's say NFTs, and you want to see if anyone has collected that or know any of that information, then you could just go in there, type in looking for NFT datas sets, and you know, chances are someone will be helpful at least, or tell you, you know, you should have used the search function, and you know, we've already seen this so many times or something. I don't know. That's how people do it on Reddit. But yeah, so just start with the data, just to explore, find out what's out there. You know, don't get bogged down about like the other questions around how much data, because there's always methods that you could do to either grow your data set or things like that. But it's a great place to start, and I think it's always fun because you can get other ideas of what you might want to predict after that. So I'll give you an example. For instance, like this designing work that we're doing, you know, we thought, oh, we're going to like find people's profiles and we'll see how many likes and comments there are. And that's going to be what's important, because we'll try to predict what's going to be trending in the future based on all of this information. But then once we got to the data, and then we said, oh, you know what? There's, you know, obviously in a design for those images as well, because this is their work. How about we make a thing that can like help people connect based on the actual work that they're doing, instead of like connecting on, you know, what's being trending or the comments, because most of the comments were very positive. So we worked on these sort of things. So starting with the data can also lead you to new questions that you never knew you would ask until you start getting down to it and start collecting or, you know, exploring data sets that are out there.
That's incredible. First of all, I should have known that there was a subreddit for that.
There's a subreddit for everything.
Is this the one you're thinking about? Is this the one?
Exactly. Yeah, data sets.
Okay. This is, and I'm going to just, you already know, we're going to put this in the doc right here. I didn't even know about this.
What's the first one? Look how specific that request is. It's like need Chinese something. Chinese resident, someone possessing Baidu account. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, zero comments now, so maybe not gonna be productive there, but yeah, I mean, you could get really specific on these sorts of things.
Wow, that's crazy. Okay, so you're looking for things like this, and you mentioned like Kaggle. How would you spell that?
Kaggle, Kaggle.
Kaggle. I was all over the place.
Yeah, sorry.
No worries. No, listen, I mean, I don't think that's a common name or a common word.
I don't know
right
where
there
it comes from. I should look it up.
Okay, cool. This is real. Listen, guys, if you're talking about like, look at what you just learned this quickly in this call. I mean, this is the secret sauce. Like right here, seeing all of these things, knowing where to look, how to get started, like already, like that's crazy. Okay, so I'm putting this in the doc. And by the way, if you're looking at this, you're saying, wait, where are all these notes are going to be? We're having a new thing coming out. Everyone live can see this. This is a brand new project we've got. It's called Docs Docs. It's going to be housing all of the notes. So what we've been talking about for months, almost an entire year, you're going to see all how to get started, what you need to be doing on trending topics or most requested topics, all of those things. It's going to be coming out for Black Friday, and this is going to be in it. Of course, if you're watching this replay or live, remember, this is free. You're always seeing all the stuff free, what we do in real time. But Doc Stocks, that's going to be our new Black Friday product that's coming out. So stay tuned. This is really good stuff. People are saying, hey, in the chat. Hey, everybody. Great to see you. I think that Aisha.
Hello.
Yeah, this is great. And of course, I'm sorry, Corey, you can't see it. I've got Restream and StreamYard, so there people are hanging out in different spots. So you're seeing some people over there. So yeah, this is good. Awesome, awesome, awesome. By the way, I cannot take credit. Justin, shout out to Justin. A year ago, he's like, you need to make it called Doc's Doc. And I was like, nah. And I was like,
and, 1 year later,
yeah, perfect yeah. name. I was like, you know, that is pretty good. Let me just go with that. And his main job, although he's a developer and everything, he has every single time, I think he's come up with like five of my product names. And he can do it just during lunch. He just names it all the time. So, nice. Yeah, he's just awesome. Okay, so this was really good already having all of those things. Okay, where should you start? The next question is, like, what data do I need and why? Could you just talk about, like, on a concept level of, like, for people to think about, like, where can they get data? Can it be in a spreadsheet? Like, how much data? Can it just be, like, one cell? Could you kind of talk about, like, how much we're talking here?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So you can always think about data as that you have an input and you have an output, and that input being the data that you're going to give it with some sort of label, and the output is actually going to be what the model predicts on. So one of the examples that I really like soccer, and I'm a huge, I should be wearing one right now. I'm surprised I'm not, but it's getting colder here in Stockholm. But as an identifier as far as what you take a soccer shirt, and it's going to predict what team that is. So let's say I want to walk around, in a city, and I see all these great shirts, and I'm like, I don't know. I don't want to like go up to the person and ask, like, that's really awkward. So I'll just take a photo of them, because that's less awkward, I guess. And then my AI model will tell me, oh yeah, this is, you know, Arsenal, or this is the US men's national team or something like that. So if I want to think about that, what do I need to give the model to learn from? Well, obviously I need to give it a whole bunch of images of these football shirts or these soccer shirts, because that will be what the model will learn from. And I need to give it some sort of label labeling it. So saying, oh, this is one team, this is another team X, team Y, team Z. Because then next thing I'll have is that when the model sees a new shirt, it's going to have the output being their prediction. So you want to build a data set that has those elements. You want to have, the input, what am I going to give the model? And then the outputs is like the training data. So the data that the model will see first, and then hopefully in the future, this output or the predictions is where the model will make the new predictions for new photos that it sees or new images. And that's tricky because sometimes in data sets, you might have like, your example, you get a CSV, let's say from Kaggle, and you might have like, 23 columns of this data from, let's say, sales data is pretty popular, or let's say the stock market, you have the company, how many employees, all of these things that could be important for the model to consider or not important. So you want to make sure that you get some data, and then you want to say, like, what do I need to know if I was an expert or mimicking the model that would be important to me to make a prediction? Like, maybe the website of the company isn't important to predict its stock. So I don't necessarily need to stress about finding data on that or cleaning it in such a way, but obviously the financial data, its performance, revenue, profits, employee numbers, things like this could be very important for a model to predict from. So you always want to say, like, what are the relevant things, and then find data based on that. So you might not find a data set that has everything, and you might have to combine those things. And that takes time. It's not never getting away with any of that stuff. But it would be something you have to consider.
Great stuff. Love it. By the way, Lee's talking about in the chat, he's an Arsenal fan right there. So
Gunners, loving yes.
what you're saying.
I never really, when I shared that example, I never exposed myself as an Arsenal fan. Not that I'm not proud, but I don't want to have any issues. But I'm glad that we have a Gunner on the line.
Listen, they're coming out of the woodworks for you. This is awesome. This is good. Now, I wrote a couple notes on inputs. I want to make sure that I have it correctly. So what I'm going to be giving the model, I'm thinking about like the CSV or something. Like, I'm just grabbing that. And then what do I need to know to make a prediction? So that way, would I necessarily eliminate certain columns that I don't need to even bring into that? Like, so if it's like you mentioned the website, would I even delete that or just like keep it?
If you have it, it's fine because it could be relevant for later on if you and we could talk about even like retraining or improving a model. So don't remove it per se, but then you don't have to like go out and let's say go and find it or something like this. So if you have a data set that has unnecessary columns or unnecessary data, it's always great to keep it because then I'm never it's like burning books. Like for me as a person working in AI, it's like, oh, don't delete the data. Like, don't burn the books. You crazy? So just keep it. You might need it for other things, other projects, and it's great to have. But yeah, you want to still keep it relevant to what you want, you need to, what you feel you need to collect, as far as what, again, the predictions. How if I were to be the model or learn from what's going to be relevant for the actual making a good prediction.
Love it. And then just real quick in for the output, how would you describe the output to someone?
Yeah, I mean the output is just really again the prediction, right? What the label is. So in most cases, it's predicting one thing, or it could predict multiple labels. For example, like we could build a model that has an image, and you want the model to predict like, okay, what's actually in the scene? So this is a beach, and it's sunny, or a beach, and it's a stormy beach, something like that. So in that case, if you want to do multiple labels, then you need to know, okay. Let me collect data sets or data that has all of those things. And I guess to even segue to some of the questions we have about how much data that we need, you want to then have a good representation of all of those examples, right? So you don't want to have like 30 images of sunny beach and then only one image of a stormy beach because in your product, and if someone takes a photo of a stormy beach, the model really hasn't learned from that very much. So you want to have some fairness or equity around these examples and labels that you're doing.
Okay, excellent. By the way, you can see on the screen in a second, Lee likes you even more now that he knows this about you. So this is
Fair enough.
great.
Yes.
This is good. Thank you very much. Okay, so now we have the structure of inputs and outputs, and I think that's really clear. You gave some great examples to kind of just structure this. Okay, great. All right. So as we're getting started, is it all right if I give you some examples and we kind of just rapid fire and kind of talk about some things?
Oh yeah, that's what I love to do. So let's do it.
Okay, good times. Now, remember, everyone, if you're watching live in the comment section, if you're thinking about AI or machine learning, what your projects are going to be doing, let us know. And then also, too, if you're watching a replay, let us know as well. And we'll kind of go through a couple of these examples. Okay, so we've got actually, oh, wow, okay, people are coming in. Okay. Oh, 1 second. All right, so I'm going to go with one that I have prepared, and then I got to bring over. People are asking about Cloud Vision API with Google. Okay. So, real quick, the first one is this is something that I saw on Product Hunt the other day. And
Nice.
what they were doing was they had like we remember what I was talking about. It's like I need this to do this for like NFTs. I want to know like upcoming projects. And I was like, I want to know the difference in like their Discord and all of these things. Now, this is excellent that they've already done it for me. Now they're charging necessarily, and I'm like, how many ETH am I gonna? They want me to
Yeah.
mint something. I'm like, okay, but I think I can do this. I was like, I think I can do this. If they've already identified and found all of these data points and structured something like this, how could I do this myself? Now, this is very advanced. This looks beautiful. For my own advantages, I do not think I need to have a dashboard that looks this great. But
It looks good. It
could
looks
you?
good.
Yeah, I mean, I'm like, my God, it looks good. I mean, that's why they're trying to make me pay for this. But could you explain just a few things of like how could I start doing something like this? Where would I start looking for the data or something like this? Because I'm seeing their Twitter followers, they're looking at the increase over 24 hours. They're looking at some likes, some retweets, and then they have the Discord members, 7 day member growth, 24 hours, 7 days, which is great indicators. Would this be something for AI and machine learning to be able to do the aggregate for this dashboard?
Yeah, I mean, so this is great. Like you said, it's a very clean, already displayed data set almost. Like, it's just a matter of using any tools to capture all of this and put that in a workable format. But then the idea is, again, to like the prediction, then like, what do we want the AI to spit out or predict to us, whether it's predicting the price, for example. So we have all of these other, these what we call features. And so that maybe the community score is, you know, the Twitter followers, you take the 7-day follower growth, and these are all columns in your data set. And then the price itself is what the model would predict. And then you could say, oh, well, based on all of this, let me get a new project that's not on this list. I'll fill in all that information and I can predict the price. So you always want to have, especially when you do price predictions and stuff like that, a good objective metric that you're predicting on. So the model can use and find all those other features that you built and then use that to make a prediction. And what's really nice about AI and even the platform Peltarian, it will give you what we call like a confidence score, or you know how confident the model is based on that prediction. So you can even know once you get into testing how well your model is performing and you know how well you could like you know throw all your ETH at this one project because you know the model says that you know it's pretty confident on the actual prediction it provided. So I think this is really great. I'm not sure if the community, I don't know if you know, but like, is the community score something that they've made up or is that something else that?
That is a really good question. Oh, the community score in general where it's upvoting right here?
No, the community score. So it's collection, mint price, and then community score.
You know what? That's a really good question. That's a really good question. I do not know. Maybe can I click on it? Can I? They're adding things all the time.
No labels on the columns?
Oof. No.
Amateur.
This is coming to me.
NFT scoring. Yeah. They're going to get me.
See, I've got nothing here. I wish I knew. Okay. So that's interesting because I need, I would love that because again, like you mentioned, I see these, which is makes sense, but I'm like, I don't know how they're collecting that. That's so interesting. See, this is why you have an expert like this.
This could be, this could be either AI or machine learning that's making this. So like, for instance, to give another use case, we have a team also on the Startup Accelerator that's kind of doing some diversity and inclusion indexes or scores. Yeah. And it's collecting, and they're collecting loads of stuff about the companies, like pay gap percentage, if they're climate change scores, and there's like tons of these like scores that these companies, you know, work to collecting, and then they are going to then assign a new score, like their own, like index score, for example, and then use AI to sort of build upon that. So this could be another thing like they've probably made up. That's why there's no, information tab is that like the community score is something that they calculate based on all of these other things. And it's probably using some sort of model with deep learning or just traditional sort of machine learning. So it could be that.
Interesting. I'm going to throw one more and then I'll go into like on Twitch, people like, get this one. Okay. I got you. This is something. So as you were talking, this one has a lot of different information. I'm not sure. They just did a whole article about people like OpenSea had a problem because whatever their API, they could see it what it was going to do like pre-mint, like what was happening. And then they started looking at projects. So then they got in really, really early and just doing it. As you were talking about NFT scoring, I feel like even understanding what the floor is in upcoming projects and looking at it straight from OpenSea, that might give you a clear indication or something to look at. When you were saying that, I was like, okay, that makes sense. These things, it allows me to see mint price and all those. But if I'm looking for perhaps different projects that are going to pop on the secondary market, where a lot of projects like gain that traction after the initial mint, I can start looking at fluctuations of the floor price right here. And I guess maybe like in the like 12-hour, 6-hour, whatever block to look at that upswing and then get it like that.
Yeah. I mean, the whole idea is that the prediction that there's something in the relationship or something that we can learn from all of these elements or features that could help us make predictions in the future. Essentially, so there probably is something that connects all of these projects that you know pop off, if you will, whether you know, Discord count, Twitter followers, something like this, that you could kind of track and you especially get it over time to then show, this is a project that you know has some sort of similarity or relationship with existing or prior projects, and then I'll hop on it and see. Spend the ETH and see how it goes, So I think that's a great example. Yeah.
Good times. All right, excellent. So next up, we have a question about OCRs and specifically Cloud Vision. I'm not sure if you've worked with it before, but yeah. So the question is talking about just being able to start with like OCRs. How many different pictures do they need to do, like to start feeding the information? This one's kind of generic. By the way, Tom, if you have more questions, or I'm trying to see. Oh man, no. That was not from Twitch. We have people watching from D Live. Hold on a second. Man, people all over on this one. People don't even comment to me on D Live about this. All right, okay. You're doing something special for it.
That's great.
Thank you so much for being here. So yeah, so OCRs. First of all, could you explain to the audience like what OCR stands for or what they are in general?
Yeah, I mean, so it depends on what you want to do as far as OCRs. I mean, you can use OCR to sort of detect things and understanding the text. So let's say you have, we're working with a company that was working on like documents, legal documents, and you want to have, you know, what's in this legal document and also OCR, the signatures or who signed it. And then you would know based on who signed it, you know, this is a government document or this is a private document or something like that. So it's definitely just using a model to sort of understand first, know what the text is and understand exactly what was being said there. So that's, I mean, with
Sorry, they just added more. They're talking about understanding document types and being able to pick out words. I think they're looking for, it sounds like something legal. They're trying to look for very specific legal terms, and Okay. Now they're sorry. It's coming in real time.
This is great. I love them like getting this, like playing the phone. Breaking news.
Yeah. You gotta do in the world. I need a sound effect for that. Hold on. I think I got it. They were talking about trying to explain it like a fifth grader. So legal, something's happening in like legal terms and then being able. Oh, okay. Now it's entertainment. Okay. So they are trying to help entertainers understand contracts. And okay. So looking at a contract and then explaining to them, either making it sound easier or also just for them to like have red flags, like they should not enter a contract with like this kind of wording or something like that. That's very specific. Yeah. Could that be something OCR does or anything like that, Corey?
Yeah, so I guess outside of just OCR, which is kind of taking text and just basically being able to sort of prove what is in the text. So, yeah, that's kind of really not necessarily AI, for example. But we also, on top of that, is NLP or natural language processing, which is what you're probably aiming towards, is how do we get models to actually understand the text? And that's super important because then you could, the model would make predictions to this example of legal documents of making a prediction of what, let's say, you know, the sentiment is behind this text. Either it's a financial statement or is it commercials or something like this. And what you'd want to do in that case, how it would sort of tackle this problem, is start, you know, just finding legal contracts that entertainment people have signed, start taking segments out. That are you think are important or the ones that you want the model to predict on, and then label them. So this could be, you know, either the different categories that covers that those topics, or like you said, red flag, certain things that might be, again, the text. And what's super nice about this is that the model, NLP models don't need to see the exact wording again. So that it's not like you're doing control F on the contract and just finding the wording. Oh, is that, you know, is that this will look like a scam or something? But it's you're finding relationships so that when it sees existing relationships later on, then you could, it would say, oh, this sounds very similar to what I've seen or was trained on, and make those labels. So it's just a matter of first identifying those concepts and like targeting and building sort of a data set around them. And then I think the next thing, which is about like generating text or making simple explaining, is another whole nother world of NLP. Around text generation. So you can see a lot of things like GPT-3 that is out there. So if you have access, definitely jump into that. That can kind of, you know, if you have a model, kind of treats it and makes simple language and stuff like that. So there's tons of stuff out there, and it's a great field. But the first step is like identifying the text, I think. So getting a model to identify that text and use NLP is great.
You know, and I think this is really good that you just mentioned this. We talk about it just on off. I usually just tell people like go talk to Corey or go check out Peltarion because
I
they
haven't
can
met many
explain.
people through the go talk to Corey method, so it's great.
That's so interesting what you said, and like you broke down. I think when you were talking about like the learning, understanding the difference or understanding like different terms, if it's really AI, is this like deep learning? Is this different things? I love how you mentioned it. So you mentioned natural language processing right here, and that's what why we're always talking about like check out Peltarion, talk to different ones that are experts because they can tell you the nuances and what you need to do to succeed. So I love that you just like broke that down, just like whoop whoop, put that right there. So we're putting that in the chat for you.
I think that's really important to again to talk about like the different AI problem types. Once you get that in your head and get those concepts, and then it's super easy to talk to people and you get the use cases. And then okay, here's how I would do it. And AI normally sits within an environment in some cases. So like I said, you have AI to identify what's in the text and maybe use another model to generate and make the text simpler. But you need to first have that. And there's also things like robot process automation or RPA that you can use AI, but some cases might only use robot process automation. And I get and one of those things is like I had a team that wanted to talk to me and they wanted to say, I want to take the AI and whenever we get a job ad, the AI posts it everywhere else, like all the new jobs and job boards and stuff like that, which is really great, but you don't really need AI to do any of that. Like that's something you could just build in an automation type of fashion, and that like that AI doesn't need to make any predictions on that. They just need to do a certain job, which that's what's the difference is, I think, that some people don't know.
That's but I want it. Just tell me, Corey, even though I could do it with automation, can I just use AI? Yeah,
Just do
that
it. Just do it, AI.
yeah. That's great. Again, we just put it in the chat, Peltarion. Make sure that you check it out. We're going to be doing this now. Remember, get in your questions now. Listen, Corey's a busy man. He's doing different things. He's leading cohorts.
Got
So,
time.
I mean, come on now. So, we're going to be talking about this. Let's switch over just to a couple crazy things that are going on with Peltarion. What I really liked was the course. That to get started with the Fast AI course, really like that course. I had to take tons of notes and keep going back, but I thought it was super helpful to get started, and I felt like I understood a little bit. But you know what? It almost feels like I'm not. You've seen that like meme of like Hacker Man. It's from like I. You once you learn a little bit, I'm like I can solve everything. And then I talk to Corey. I'm like it's just the beginning. Could you talk about a little bit what you've got going on at Peltarion, Fast AI, and also the cohort and what you guys got going on over there?
So the Faster AI course, I think, is a great place to start your AI journey. And like to your point, it doesn't end with that course. That's probably just really the spark that probably will light your fire on asking more AI questions. But I mean, we really try to make it accessible for people that haven't been exposed to anything with AI, and we kind of really focus on what we talk about AI, deep learning models, these sort of terms. We don't just throw them out there and expect everyone to know what they mean. And then also the framework of looking at problems and use cases and defining how AI can solve them. And I, to be honest, I mean, we on the platform, we make modeling super easy, and we also make deploying them into applications super easy. So that was great because then all the hard work you can really dedicate to, which is finding out how to define the problem, understanding what the capabilities and the use cases are, finding the data, which takes a lot of time as well. And then once you get that going, you can just continue to iterate and improve on that using our platform. So I highly recommend if you haven't done anything with AI, or even if you have some experience, it's a great refresher to take the Faster AI course. Because it gives you that sort of framework of thinking, because it's a different thing than traditional development or product development. Because again, you're working with them, you're telling the machine to do something new, and not talking about predictions and stuff like that is something maybe you have to get your head around, I think, before you can really start getting productive.
Love it. And by the way, everyone, you know how we always talk about like finding the gems? This is it. This is it. And they're offering this for free. Okay, you know how much we love free around here as well.
Yeah.
So
we have a Black Friday deal as well. It's completely free.
Oh my God. Okay, get it now. It's starting next week. We'll put drop the links. That's excellent. That's awesome. Love to see it. And of course, if you're watching a replay, we'll have in the description. Check down below somewhere. It will be there. Just two more questions. And then we'll get you out. So tell us about the cohort. How can people apply? How often do you do the cohort? Who's perfect for it? Tell us a little bit about this.
Yeah. So we have a startup accelerator program, or no code AI accelerator program, where we take in teams. Primarily, it's been teams that have some sort of idea. Maybe they even already kind of built some wireframes. But we like to say we meet you wherever you are. We will all finish in the 6 weeks building an MVP. So even if you have no idea about AI or built anything on the platform, that's completely okay. We will help you first do all of, like I said, the frameworking and the business case, which we are currently in our third cohort and it's week four now coming up. And people are like super stressed, like, oh God, like I need to, I'm not sure if I'm going to get to this 6 weeks and build something. And I was like, it's completely fine. Like, actually, we give ourselves 6 weeks because probably by the end of the fifth week, we finally figured out what to do. And that's the hard part, like figuring out what to do and how to do it. And then doing it, especially with Peltarian, is super easy and iterating on that and improving it. So that is like where we really focus on, building the frameworks, the use cases, finding the data. So these sorts of things that you can't really do on the platform per se, but are super critical to doing that. You can do that. And we would run this program. So it's 6 weeks. So normally right after the program, we have one coming up. So the next one actually will be in January. So I think if you click on, I think learn or something like that, Doc, we have the accelerated program there, the courses, under courses.
There we go. Perfect.
So you could see the topics. Every week we do a specific group session, and then you also get assigned a mentor, which is either myself, are those two lovely individuals. We've actually expanded our mentorship this time. We have 13 teams. Before the last cohort, we had 8 teams. So it's ever growing and we're always ready to support. And the program has no sort of tuition costs. We do, the only requirement that we have is that you upgrade to a pro plan, or a plus plan, sorry, while you're in the program, because we run multiple models and you need sort of the technical resources available on that plan. And ideally you would launch this and make it a commercial product. So that's also super great for us to see our platform and the products that the teams have built out in the wild.
Good times. Love it. Love it. Love it. All right. Remember, in the link down below, this is really good. Like, this is the thing. In the no code community, I feel like there's just so much giving and so much information and expertise. You just have to go out and do it. Like we talk about, there's another section of the show or things that we do on the platform. We call it action over ideas. Like, there's a certain amount that you can just read about, but you've just got to execute. You just got to start going out. And cohorts like this, and having experts that will be your mentors that could charge thousands of dollars easily per month.
I do accept tips, though, Doc.
Okay, that's true. Okay, that's totally fine. Buy me a coffee. We'll make sure we'll do the link for Corey. It's amazing. So, again, take the time. Do all these things. Do your research. See if this would be right for you. And randomly, someone in the last cohort said that they found Peltarian, like my demo video, and then they joined the cohort. I was like, that's crazy.
Oh, nice.
So again, like, really good stuff, and they end up loving it. So again, if you're interested in this and you're like, Doc, like, where do I begin? I'm always about just giving you to the experts. Like, I'll tell you like what I would be thinking, but like how to really scale up quickly is you go to ones that are experts like Corey and others to really start maximizing and getting your ideas out there into the world. Okay, so we're wrapping up. Where can the good people find you at? Do you want them to hit you up on Twitter? Do you want them to email you? What's the best place?
Yeah, Twitter is the best place for me. So I'm at Corey Space. K-O-R-E-Y. Yeah, my parents, they made it confusing for everyone. So it's K-O-R-E-Y space. So just the word space.
Got it.
So yeah, Corey Space.
Got it. And what I'm going to do is, of course, in the chat down below, I'm going to drop Corey's Twitter, just URL, everything like that. So you can go find him, ask him questions, and tip him as well. Don't just be a vampire. Tip the man. And we'll go from there. Again, everybody, and thank you for your time for being here. This is just the beginning. This is, remember, this is to get you started for 2022. It's right around the corner, y'all. Okay, so
quick, yeah.
Think about what you want to do. You've got all of these different options in the no-code space. This is the time to start capitalizing, understanding what AI can do, machine learning can do in your no-code project. Check out Corey and everything going on with Pelterion. And remember, let us know what you're building, what you're trying to accomplish. This is about action over ideas. So again, thank you so much for being here. Everyone in the chat, thank you so much. And Corey, thank you so much for being here. And
thanks for having me. This has been great. Yeah.
Good times, everyone. All right. Well, as always, we'll be back next week with another episode. Don't want to give too much away. It just has to do with locksmiths and what you would do with no code. So we'll talk about that next week. Again, thank you so much for watching, everyone. And have a great night. Bye, everybody.